It's a good day, and today I will be discussing the concept of RCC retaining wall and its design. In this concept, you will be discussing the retaining wall. There are two types of retaining wall which we will be covering, that is a cantilever and a counterfort retaining wall by reinforced cement concrete. So there are different types of retaining wall, and why this comes under foundation. Generally, the earlier concept we studied the foundation, and next we are coming here for retaining wall. Retaining wall is generally a foundation oriented structure. Why? Because it retains the soil. Hence, this topic better covers under a footing. And there are non-reinforced retaining wall too. Let us discuss. And before going to the design, we should know certain concept and the terminologies to understand the design. So let me show you a structure which we are going to design. See, this retaining wall is built in a highway, and you can see the reinforcement which is from the bottom towards the level of the road. So the reinforcement height will be increased to the level of the road. So this component, and these are the terminologies which while studying a retaining wall we have to know. This is a stem, you can see that, which is similar to a tree. So this is a root component, that is, this is a footing component. The footing consists of two elements, that is a toe element and a heel element. So the heel element will be inside the soil, which is retained. And in the other side, you can see a bottom level of soil, and this end is known as toe end of a retaining wall. And you are having a last component of footing key. We need this component in order to resist the shear force which is created by the soil. So if we are resisting the soil active pressure, so there will be a horizontal pressure in the stem, also a vertical pressure which will be acting in the footing. So in order to resist that, there will be, due to this horizontal force, what happens, the retaining wall tends to slide. So in order to resist the sliding force, we can provide a shear key or sliding key. It is provided, and there are different types of force which is acting, which you can see a upgrade. So after this, there might be a highway. You can see the retaining wall will be constructed to the level of the natural subgrade. So after that, there will be the embankment. So the soil embankment will be in some range, and this is known as the sloped backfill. So you will be filling the soil, and then the road starts. So due to this, there will be some additional loads. This is called surcharge load. What do you mean by surcharge? It is not the force created by the dead load of the soil. See, there is a soil here, nobody gives any external force, but due to the internal angle of friction, you will be having an active earth pressure. And the surcharge is another load. If you are constructing a highway retaining wall, then the load due to the traffic might be a surcharge load. So the load which is coming in the road will be transferred to the soil, and this load also affects the whole soil. And you have to design your retaining wall in order to resist this surcharge load. And the main layer is called principal reinforcing. this is the principal reinforced layer. Why? Because this is the tension side. See, if a force is acting in this cantilever section, you can see that due to the horizontal force, the right hand part of the stem gets the tension force and left hand side of the stem has compressive force. So the reinforcement is primarily provided in tension side. Also, you can provide the same reinforcement in the compression side. This is the primary reinforcement. You can see a long line. This is known as the main bar. So main bar starts from the bottom of the footing and it extends to the top of the stem. And also there will be distribution bar which will be connected by all the main bars throughout the dimension. You can see the vertical bars are known as the main bar and here horizontal bars are known as distributors. And due to the thermal force, you can have temperature or shrinkage reinforcement. If you are only providing reinforcement at tension, you need additional reinforcement. Or if you are providing reinforcement in both the section, this reinforcement will be capable of handling shrinkage and temperature forces. And you will be having, this is known as the lower grade and this is known as the upper grade. Upper grade might be a horizontal level or there might be some backfilling, and this is known as the footing width. So footing width generally consists of the dimension of toe and the dimension of heel of the retaining wall. So overall dimension is known as the footing width, and the height from the bottom of the footing to the lower grade is known as embedment, and the height from the top of the heel to the upper grade is known as retained height. So this is the retained soil height. This is the second type of retaining wall. This is a counterfort retaining wall. If you are going for higher height, it may be more than 6 meter or 7. In this case, you can go for a counterfort retaining wall. For smaller heights, you can go for a cantilever retaining wall. For higher heights, the pressure will be high, the bending moment will be high. Due to that, there is a counterfort wall which is built here. So this wall is known as counterfort wall. This takes the moment which is created by the high wall, high backfilling soil. So this is the stem and this is the footing area. You can see the natural counterfort retaining wall. You can see the counterforts are provided perpendicular to the wall. Naturally, you can see that this is the heel portion where the soil is retained and which is the toe portion on the other hand. And next part, while designing a retaining wall, what are the important forces which you have to consider in order to design any of the retaining wall? So first one, you should have acceptable factor of safety with respect to overturning. So overturning is a factor which the overall retaining wall will overturn with respect to the bottom. So you should have a acceptable factor of safety. And sliding, this is another failure criteria which you have to note, that your sliding force created due to the earth pressure, you should find, and then you should apply a factor of safety to consider into the design. And third thing is allowable soil bearing pressure are not exceeded. See, before construction of any structure, you should have a soil bearing pressure. Note that while finding the bearing pressure, in design of footing, we have found out the bearing pressure, soil bearing pressure, and then the moment is arrived. Here, the same process will be followed. So the soil bearing pressure, if it is 200 kilonewton per meter square is the bearing pressure of the soil, you should note that the load which is coming to the retaining wall should not exceed the bearing pressure of the soil. And the fourth one, the stress within the component, they are stem and footing, are within code allowable limits and adequately resist imposed vertical and lateral loads. And last one, it is equally important that it is constructed according to the design. So according to Indian standard codes IS 456, if we are following a concrete design, then you have to follow IS 456 for this design. This is the free body diagram of a cantilever retaining wall. So earlier we saw the components, but now we will go into the mechanics of the retaining wall. See, this is the backfill and this is the stem portion and the heel and toe portion. What are all the forces which is acting? If we are drawing into a free body diagram, the soil at the top part will have zero horizontal pressure, that is active pressure. PA is active earth pressure. So there will be zero force, and if you drag it to the bottom of the structure, you will be having the maximum force due to the soil. And so the soil pressure will be in a triangle. This is active earth pressure, and the other part you will have a passive earth pressure. So the force which is created in one side is resisted by the another side. It is called as passive earth pressure. So this earth supports the force which is coming on the other side. Also we will have the passive frictional force, which will be opposite to the active frictional force which is created in the other side. The next part is, in order to identify the all the forces, see, due to this backfill and the soil property, the active earth pressure might not be perpendicular to the stem. It will be under any angle. Hence, we have to find the components of the force. What are they? This is vertical component and horizontal component. So this beta is known as angle of internal friction or angle of repose of the material. So if you know the angle of repose, you can find the components of the active earth pressure. And the centroid of this force, if any force is acting in a triangular system, you can identify the centroid will come exactly from 1/3 of the larger pressure, 1/3 of total height. So this is known as total height, and in the 1/3 of the height you will be having the forces which is concentrated. And the next force, coming to the second one, you can have, you will have the dead load. So dead load of the stem is known as the next force, and dead load of the footing is known as the next component. And there will be some lower grade soil and its self weight. So finally, the fifth force will be the backfilled soil. How much of backfilling you are providing? So these are the force which is acting on a cantilever retaining wall. At last, you will be having the soil bearing pressure. So due to this load, all the loads are transferred into the stem. So these loads are resisted by the stem, and the stem distributes this load to the footing, to the soil. So in order to have an equilibrium between the footing and the soil, you will be having the pressure distribution of the soil. So this is the pressure distribution. It may not be a triangle, it may be a trapezoid, or it may be rectangle in some case. So you have to find the bearing pressure of the soil. So how to find the earth pressure? So I said that PA is active earth pressure. So how to find the active earth pressure is, you should have the following values, that is unit weight of the material, that is the soil. You should have density of the soil and depth of point at which the pressure is sought. Next thing is angle of internal friction or angle of repose. So this is known as phi or beta. You can consider, and by using this component you can find the active earth pressure, that is how much of force which is acting in the retaining wall. And if you want to find the pressure in terms of the formula, you can have KWH, where W is unit weight of the material and H is the height of soil which is retained and K is the active earth pressure. How to find K? You have a formula, 1 minus sin phi divided by 1 plus sin phi. So phi is known as angle of internal friction. If you know that, you can find the pressure. So this pressure is known as active earth pressure. And after designing, see, note that you are finding the bending moment at bottom of the structure. You can see that we are finding bending moment at the bottom of the point. So when we are finding bending moment at the top part, you can see that the forces are less, hence the bending moment will be less. Due to this, the reinforcement also could be reduced for economical purpose. If you are going for higher walls, what you can do is either you can reduce the bar size or adopt alternate bar. From the bottom, if you are having one bar and you can remove a bar from the next reinforcement and you can prolong the reinforcement bar at the next point. So this is one case. Or you can reduce the bar dia size. So if you are using 16mm dia bar, you can reduce the diameter bar up to 10 or 8 millimeter. And the next thing is, for medium height walls, you can use the same concept here. Either you can reduce the bar size or drop alternate bar. And for the low walls, so low retaining walls, extend doubles for full height. So whatever the bar which you are providing at the bottom should be extended towards the overall height of the structure. So this is how it is detailed. And the depth which is known as, while connecting one bar and the other, you should have the development length of the bar. You can find the development length by using IS456 and you can provide while connecting the two bars. And next concept, the pressure on the retaining wall due to granular materials. See, the earth material or any other granular material like sand and cement grain, when collected in a heap, tends to adopt a slope. This is known as angle of repose. No external load is required to create angle of repose. Already, due to the way it is collected, the angle of repose is internal property of the soil. So this is due to internal friction between the grains and the material. So this you have to understand. So due to this grain, the pressure is created, and this pressure have to be taken by the retaining wall. The calculation of pressure at the base of retaining wall. In all reinforcement design, we will consider 1 meter width and we will provide all the reinforcement which is provided for a single meter. So this is how here we will proceed, and you can see that how to find the pressure. So if you know the horizontal force, after resolving the force, this is active earth pressure, that is PA, which is applied at one end due to the soil. Here you can have a retaining wall. So if you are considering only the stem portion, there will be a force which is due to the self weight of the stem, you will be having W, and there is a horizontal force due to the soil. So due to this two force, you will have a resultant force. So this will be under an angle. So this distance is known as eccentricity. The eccentricity should not go beyond E by 6. So there is a limit. According to middle third rule, it should not go beyond the limit. So that is B by 6. And you have to calculate the force, and if it is within the eccentric limit, then the structure will not suffer due to the eccentric force. Else, it will have a problem of overturning or sliding. And next, I already discussed that this is the top portion of the stem, this is bottom portion. You will be having a different dimension. Why? Because the pressure will be higher at the bottom and lower at the top. So this is why the dimension of the retaining wall is also gradually reduced. From the bottom, if the total height is h, from the bottom you can assume that h by 3 will be the point of action of force. So this pressure will be half w into h square. We already know that the active earth pressure formula is wh dot k, where k is 1 minus sin phi divided by 1 plus sin phi. So if you are substituting the pressure in this triangle, that is half bh, half the breadth here is the pressure. Next thing is h is also added again, so hence 1 by 2 wh square 1 minus sin phi divided by 1 plus sin phi. You can see a retaining wall here which is constructed and it is collapsed. So this is not a reinforced retaining wall, this is a stone retaining wall. Here you can see the natural embankment of the soil. So after the retaining wall, there will be some embankment. So you will be having the load of the building too. So this soil has the active earth pressure plus the surcharge load. And when we are talking about types of failure, so what are the modes of failure of a retaining wall? When we are constructing a retaining wall, you should be careful on the failure aspect. So these are the four important external failures. So that is, if the force of the soil which is retained is higher, then the retaining wall could be slided. This is known as sliding failure. Next thing is, if the pressure at the bottom and the moment created due to the soil is higher, then you will be having a rotation and bearing capacity failure. And the third type is deep seated failure, that is the overall soil profile can be created by a slip plane, due to that you can have a failure. And the last one is structural failure. So the moment which is not resisted by the stem, so due to this insufficient reinforcement or insufficient force transfer mechanism, you could have a structural failure. So these are the types of failure. And also there are other failures which are internal. So you can have an internal failure due to the pullout and tensile over stress. If the tensile force is higher and internal sliding, so this is the overall sliding, you can see the difference here. The overall translation, due to this you can find the external failure. And internal failure is some part of the retaining wall is being resisted and another part of the retaining wall it could not resist the force. These kind of failures could happen in segmental retaining walls. You can see there are number of segment, so due to the segment there will be some type of failures. So next one is connection failure, so which I will discuss what do you mean by segmental retaining wall. And the connection failure, due to the connection of the reinforcement and the blocks, so there might be connection failure and column shear failure, and finally a toppling of the segments. So these are the types of failure which you have to consider while design. And when we are talking about the failure mechanism, how much should be the factor of safety we should consider in order to proceed the design? The first one, what you have to do is, if you want to resist sliding force, then you have to consider 1.5 factor of safety. So whatever the force which is acting on the stem due to the soil, you should consider 1.5 times of the force higher, and then you should design. So these are the factor of safety should be considered from the natural forces, and then it should be designed for overturning 2 times, and for other forces you can have that. So in overall, a global stability about 1.3 to 1.5 times is essential for retaining wall design. Stone masonry retaining wall, and there is an embankment. This is a natural embankment. See, there will be in some case the overall height of the retaining wall, the embankment might be much higher than the height of this retaining wall. And also, this is a picture which is taken in Mysore Hills, the construction of a cantilever retaining wall, the construction process of the bottom end of the retaining wall. You can see here that the foundation work is going on. So the excavation and the foundation will be there. You can see the natural level of subgrade which is required. You can see the expected level of subgrade. So up to the expected level, you should construct a stem of the retaining wall. And these are the retaining wall which is built in many of the highways which you can see in India or throughout the world. You can see this segmental type of retaining wall. So what do you mean by segmental retaining wall is, you can see by using number of segmental units, the dimension might be according to its height, according to the total height, the segmental retaining wall could be considered. So more than 40 or above feet, you can use the segmental retaining wall with better economy when considering the reinforced cement retaining wall. The concept here is, this is the retained soil. You should have a retaining wall which is built here. So there will be some reinforced soil. So this reinforced soil consists of the coarse aggregate and a geosynthetic reinforced layer. So this layer will be prolonged from the segmental units to the height. So there will be a reinforced section. So it will be linked at one end and shear key or mechanical connector. So this is the point where these reinforcements are connected. These types of retaining wall are very economical under higher heights. And you can see a geotextile warped drain here in order to collect all the water which is collected from the retaining wall, which is connected at one end and it is drained outside. So granular leveling pad, you will not be having a footing here. So this is a material, granular material, which is used for the footing level. So the concept here which is used is mechanically stabilized earth. You are making the earth which is filled stabilized by the reinforcement and the gravel. So the length of the reinforced zone is actually 60 to 70% of the wall height. And these walls are not under 90 degree towards the natural level. It is 15 degree tilted from vertical. If you carefully watch that, you can find the inward declination. And the retaining height of 40 feet or more can be achieved by using geogrids far exceeds the economical limit. So where you can use this segmental retaining wall is hillsides alongside highway and behind shopping centers, providing tiered grade changes for development, that is highways and railroads, bridge abutment. So these are the area you can use this segmental retaining wall. And the advantage is it is fast to construct, and at the footing consists of just gravel leveling pad. So you no need to have the reinforcement and concreting. So just a gravel leveling pad is enough, and the units are dry stacked without mortar, steel reinforcement and grouting. So this is an economical part. So what are the disadvantages? You need more width. So in some cases there might not be enough area to construct a retaining wall. In those kind of area, the reinforced cement concrete retaining wall is very much useful. So if you have enough width for constructing a retaining wall, then you can go for segmental retaining wall. You can see that this is another segmental blocks, another type of segmental blocks, and the geogrids, the geogrid fiber is being connected from the segmental material, and this is another type of lock which is being provided. Here there is a cushioned pad which is interlocked by the connector here. So along the other side you will have the reinforcement. You can see that these are the reinforcement. So you will be having the retaining wall at the other end. So this area is known as the reinforcement area. It will be filled by the gravel, and both the adjacent side you will be having the reinforcement for stabilization of the soil. Okay, with this introduction, now you will be knowing what is retaining wall and what are the components of retaining wall, what are the technical name and the forces which are acting in the retaining wall, how to resist and what are the types of failure, and how to go for a design of retaining wall. So with this we will be going for the next two topics, for cantilever retaining wall and counterfort retaining wall. This will be a good foundation in order to understand better for the next topic. I hope you enjoyed this lecture. Thank you.